Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Christmas at the Mysterious Bookshop, edited by Otto Penzler, read by Matt Godfrey and Christina Delaine. Introduction. Bookstores have been a place of worship and wonderment for me since I was a child, and little has changed in the ensuing decades. One of the enduring thrills of my fortunate life is when visitors to my own store have kind things to say about it. While it is a great source of emotional joy and pride, the Mysterious Bookshop offers little in the way of financial benefits. Just ask my valued but underpaid staff. Like most independent bookshops, it engages in a mighty struggle against the chain store behemoths, the 800-pound online gorilla, and the newest attacker of old-fashioned bookstores, electronic books. Nonetheless, if we don't quite flourish, we endure. And it is largely due to the friendship of our loyal customers and the generosity of the mystery writing community. As a way of thanking our customers for their support, I have commissioned an original story from some of the finest mystery writers in America each Christmas season for the past 17 years. These stories are then published in handsome booklets and given to my customers as a Christmas present. The only criteria for the authors to follow were that the stories should be set during the Christmas season, involve a mystery, and have at least some of the action take place at the Mysterious Bookshop. The resultant stories have ranged from humorous to suspenseful to heartwarming. They have been so loved that customers from whom we rarely hear, alas, make a point of ordering books during the holiday season just to be sure they get a copy of the latest booklet. They have become highly collectible, too. Single stories selling, we have heard, for more than the price of this entire collection. None of it would be possible without the warm friendship shown by the authors of these stories, of course. Trust me when I tell you they didn't do it for the money. Even if Christmas at the Mysterious Bookshop hits the bestseller list, it won't change the lives of the contributors. It may, on the other hand, influence the life of the bookshop. My entire share of royalties goes directly to the bookshop's bank account, which will thrill my creditors. It should be pointed out that the Mysterious Bookshop, which opened on Friday the 13th of April, 1979, was located at 129 West 56th Street for nearly 27 years. It was well known for its two stories connected by a spiral staircase, with my very elegant office at the back of the second floor. The store moved down to 58 Warren Street in Tribeca in October 2004, to a larger, more modern, if less cozy, space. It's also worth mentioning that, although I am a real person, the character with my name who appears in several of these stories is fictional. Have a very Merry Christmas. Otto Penzler, 2010. The Mysterious Bookshop, 58 Warren Street, New York, New York, 10007. www.mysteriousbookshop.com. Snowberries by Megan Abbott. It's 2 days before Christmas, and the mystery bookstore, with its frosted windows and glowing lights and general aura of warm promise inside, looks like the December page tugged from a Currier and Ives calendar. Me? My shoes are shined, so there's that. I may have shaved. The store sits on the ground floor of one of those buildings people talk about when they talk about old New York, which they do a lot these days. Red brick facade, sandstone cornices and sills, a wrought iron fire escape of solid heft, the fine architectural product of the firm John B. Snook & Sons. At least, that's what the tiny brass plaque tells me. But I've always found Snook & Sons to do solid work. For 2 hours, I've been shadow dancing on the street, dodging barrel-chested holiday shoppers ready to pick me off like a clay pigeon. Mostly, I've been waiting. I walk past the store itself many times. As the day grows colder, the sun slipping behind all that red brick, I decide to stop in some of the adjacent businesses. It turns out the rubber supply establishment is no browser's delight, but the picture window at the Lily of the Nile nail spa next door offers a nice view. I stand in front of it for a moment, as if to adjust my necktie in the window reflection. It's a picture, all right. All the glossy-headed ladies bent over the delicate hands of other glossy-headed ladies. Rows and rows of slender ankles crossing each other as they sit, fingers dipped in cut glass bowls, the curves of their breasts as they lean on the chrome manicure trolleys, the low hum of whispered gossip and pleasantries, holiday parties and glittery fingertips. So far, the nail spa is definitely a highlight. When I push open the front door, the sound of a brass gong vibrates, and I feel uncannily like I've entered a creaky Charlie Chan movie. All their eyes, the blonded manicurists and manicures, lift to observe me. Suddenly, I'm glad I wore the charcoal pinstripes and got that shoe buff by City Hall. Out of all of them, only one gives me what can only fairly be described as the fisheye. The others, lit lovingly by amber candles and swollen slightly by complimentary glasses of holiday cider, almost smile, almost seem to invite me further in, waving those glittery fingertips. But it's probably just the holiday cider. Anyway, my hands will have to wait. It seems I'm working. No one at Lily of the Nile offers up anything other than the smell of paraffin, so, edging back toward the bookshop around 2 o'clock, this time I go inside. It's the kind of place you always see in old movies. Wooden bookcases that nearly curl around the store's cozy center, like cupped hands over a fire. A button-tufted leather sofa is flanked by a pair of padded back chairs with gold saddle studs along the edges, and legs curved as gracefully as the manicured ladies next door. An old book smell that calls to mind pine tar and sweet almonds, even though it's probably horse glue. Walking over to the far right bookcase, I put my hand on the smooth wood of a lower shelf, my fingers resting in a pair of tiny craters. Larger than even a Death Watch beetle could manage, but you never know. Trawling the rest of the store, I try to blend in, to look like the kind of guy who might come in for more purpose than to put his greasy thumbprints all over the slick spy novels on the front tables. The kind of guy who might actually take his time perusing the wispy rarities thrust high on the shelves, and who knows what he's looking for. Which mostly means I do a full circuit of the high shelves, squinting a lot, neck craned, a tug at my ear like I'm thinking very hard. Might this be the first British edition with the erratum on page? I almost convince myself. Walking around the far back corner, I'm doing some high-shelf squinting when something tickles my tugged ear. The legs of an overhanging skeleton. Like the kind you see at Halloween. Except Halloween was 2 months ago, and the skeleton is draped in a string of Christmas lights, the tiny white kind that don't blink, but just twinkle like far-off stars. It takes me a long time to untangle myself. I feel as sharp as a mudflat. A handsome young man with clever eyewear and a stack of Gil Brewer novels grins at me. "It's on account of mysteries," he says, nodding at the skeleton. "Get it?" "Yeah, kid. I get it." Back on the street again, struck out twice over. I'm feeling a little like Goldilocks, if Goldilocks were a middle-aged guy with a slight limp from an early morning collision with a subway turnstile. My luck may be changing, though, because it's after 3 o'clock, and the proverbial chair that's just right has finally opened its doors across the street. The Raccoon Lodge, the neon sign craned off the fire escape says, though the only sign of lodge seems to be the general smell of too many men living closely together for a long time. Still, I like a bar in the afternoon, the wood polished, the coasters in fine stacks like poker chips, the glow of the lights in the long mirror, the gleaming taps, and the beer, too, let's not forget that. So the Raccoon Lodge bar will do me just fine. Maybe even better than fine. A jowly man, seated in the far crook of the bar, dons a surprisingly perky Santa hat. Tilting his head, resting it on his palm, he is singing with great reverence the third chorus of The Holly and the Ivy. Not everyone knows the third chorus. Behind the bar, Beneath a stained glass lamp stands a small woman with tinted eyeglasses and a fringe of dark hair. Between two fingers, she balances a fat paperback, the cover torn off and the pages nicely yellowed. She makes me feel like curling up at her feet and asking for a bedtime story. Or something. I'm not taking any chances this time. I have a feeling about this one. "Can you do me a favor?" I asked, offering my best grin, the one where I use all my teeth. "A very small favor, that's a promise." If I had her eyelashes, I'd be batting them. "I don't know," she said, her voice low and with a little tickle of a rasp in it. "Favors are funny things." "I promise, this one's a real knee slapper," I say, hoping for an undeserved smile, and not getting one. But something about the way she keeps letting her eyes drift up and down my face makes me a little optimistic. "The funniest part, though, is the head," she continues, looking back down at her book. The bar light's too dim for me to catch even the half-shorn title page. "The head?" I ask, resting my elbows on the bar. I can't say as when I've been more intrigued. "You put on a show. You lift your hand high for the poor, make a big flourish out of it so everyone will be pie-eyed and empty their pockets," she says, turning a page. "But what do you get when you do that? All collar, no shirt. A glass of creamy foam."
"A tragedy,"
barks the man with the Santa cap, whom I never should have counted out. "That, my friend, would be no favor," she agrees, nodding at Santa. I realize I have been quietly rebuked. There is an order to these things, even at, or especially at, places like the Raccoon Lodge. "I know I asked for a favor," I say, slapping a $10 bill on the bar. "But first things first, a gallon of whatever you have on draft." I slide onto one of the metal bar stools, adding, "And one for St. Nick, too." She smiles, as if to herself, sets her book down and flicks one of the rusted taps, filling a slightly clouded pint glass and nudging it toward me, like the change for the fine on my overdue library books. I smile back. I like her. In her own way, she's friendly. I bet she's never even set foot in the Lily of the Nile nail spa. "Now, what were you saying? Something about a favor?" she asks. Taking a drink, I have to admit she can pull a fine head. Just the whisper of a head. "It's about that establishment across the street, the bookstore," I say. "You ever go in there?" She tilts her head. "Do I look like the type?" Now I have full permission to look her up and down. That fitted sweater of sapphire blue darting nicely in all kinds of nice places. The eyeglasses, which, though small, form a vaguely forbidding lattice across what seems a very satisfactory face. I can't see the legs, but I have a strong, favorable impression just the same. I'd put her just this side of 40. But whichever side it is, it's the side I like. She's a delicate one, though, especially for the dingy setting. The spun glass type, I'd say, if I were the kind of guy to say spun glass. Or if this were the kind of place to say it, what with those stained glass lamps, the stained glass of which, now that I've adjusted to the dark interior of the bar, appear to be slowly peeling from their hot centers. "Well," I say, both of us turning to look out the front window toward the frost-laced bookstore across the street. "In an even match, I'd put you in there over this joint." Shrugging, she taps her fingers on the bar top. "I've grown up here," she says. "Known these swollen floors since I was knee-high to a grasshopper." "Guess I'm wrong again," I say. "So, was that the favor?" she asks. "Nearing the final bend," I say. "Sorry about all the head. I'm just wondering if you've ever seen the proprietor." "I don't know," she says. I believe her. Who couldn't believe her? All apple cheeks and inky fingers and away with a foam head. If it weren't for those memorable sweater darts, I'd want to adopt her. "Could you tell me what he looks like, the owner?" So this is the favor part, she says. Clearly a woman who counts her favors with the precision of a blackjack dealer. I nod. She leans forward, tapping her fingers to her chin. If it's the man I think it is, she says. Silver hair, silver beard. This time of year, gray herringbone coat, fly front. Looks custom made. A voice kind of clubby. Crisp, but buoyant. Someone comfortable speaking in public. I'm guessing he's a native New Yorker who spent some formative years in the Midwest, let's say Michigan. And a one-time baseball player.
Eyes wide, I say. By his gait?
By the mitt he carries, she says. Right-handed, hand-stitched.
I stare at her. She grins, dimples, diamond sharp.
I'm a little in love. Whenever the Wolverines win, she says, he whistles hail to the victors as he walks by.
Taking my glass of beer, I silently toast her, Santa, and the stuffed animal suspended above the bar. I think it may be a wild boar. Something about the tusks alarms me.
You'd make a good cop, I say.
No thanks, she says, tilting her head back and gazing up to the porcine taxidermy above her head. I'll stick to the mounted kind.
When was the last time you saw him?
Maybe a week ago, she says,
picking up a green swizzle stick and twirling it between her fingers.
Is he in some kind of trouble?
Let's just say he's an elusive one. Bespoke herringbone and all.
Herring is a slippery fish, she says,
the swizzle dancing impressively across her pretty white knuckles.
In Europe, they call it the silver of the sea.
Where I come from, we call it two-eyed steak. Realizing I'm starting to get hungry, I look around for a tin plate of pretzels, some Mr. Peanut, anything.
You're mildly interesting, she says. For a Wednesday.
And Christmas Eve to boot, I say, taking another sip of my beer. She touches her fingers to the cover of her book, as if to return to it. But the swizzle stick seems to interest her more.
You must pull bottom rank to be working so close to the holiday, officer, she says, her voice slightly sharpening. Like those poor cops in Times Square on New Year's Eve.
I'm an independent contractor, I say, suddenly feeling the heat coming from that peeling stained glass, wishing we could go back to our sprightly routine from a few minutes back. Not a cop. She nods hesitantly as if she's not sure she believes me. Is it unusual not seeing him for a week? I ask, the last bloom of beer restoring my balance on the lurching stool.
I don't keep such close tabs, she says, and there's a funny kind of pause.
Turning back to Santa, she says, a little flutter in her voice.
Hey, mister. How about here we come wassailing?
Santa lifts his head with surprising buoyancy.
We have got a little purse of stretching leather skin,
he croons fairly mightily. Raccoon Lodge's own Falstaff. Lifting his glass, he takes a quick slug.
We want a little of your money, he continues, winking, to line it well within.
The comely bartender turns around and faces me again. I smile, a little differently now. So is that another hint? I say, leaning back, my voice a little tighter. You two working as a team? She flinches a little.
No,
she says, furling her brow.
I'm just looking for a little holiday merriment.
Suddenly, I feel very sorry, for a lot of reasons, beginning with that furled brow. About one more round. And this time you join us, I say, resting another bill on the bar. The smile comes back, but she only pulls a glass for me and for Santa, whose head now rests dreamily on the bar lip. No tipple, I ask, enjoying the first sip of that second beer to an almost heart-bursting degree. I'm not much for Christmas.
It'd interfere with my hobbies,
she saws, twirling two swizzle sticks now in fast succession. Let me guess, I say, nearly hypnotized by the dancing sticks. former majorette. She laughs, bell-like. If only I'd gone to college. I could have been a star.
Oh, I say. I thought you were a Big Ten girl.
Not me, she says, the swizzles slowing almost imperceptibly across her knuckles. That's Mr. Across the Street, remember? Or that was just my guess about him.
Huh, I say, shrugging. She keeps twirling. Tugging my ear, I look at her and add,
but you do know when the Wolverines win. You could only make the connection between his whistle and a win if you knew about the win.
She looks at me.
The win is just a guess, based on when he whistles.
But you recognize the fight song, I say. She sends the swizzles into the air and spinning around.
You bartend long enough, you know all the songs.
Well, I say, nodding. Majorette is safer than linebacker.
And requires better aim, she says.
You said it, not me, I say, smiling. She smiles too, though she doesn't seem sure why. She doesn't yet have the sinking feeling I have. At least I don't think she does. But the specs help, I add. With the aim, right? She sets down the swizzle sticks and touches her fingers to her eyeglasses self-consciously. The gesture is so soft and girlish and shy. It's like she's forgotten them and I've reminded her. The truth is, I want her to take them off because in a different story, not this one, she would. She'd take them off and she'd let down her dark hair and I'd walk Santa to the back exit with an extra bill to make him happy, and when I returned, she'd be pulling down the blinds with a slightly awkward, utterly charming curtsy. And I'd walk close, smelling the perfume I imagine she wears as she dims the lights and... Well, but that's not the world we live in, not today at least. And I'm working. I am working. Dorothy Parker had it all wrong, I say. I love a woman in glasses. All the same, she takes them off. And I can see her eyes, so brightly gray as to be nearly silver, the lashes stuttering just slightly. I take a long drink of my beer. They've always given me trouble, my eyes, she says. I make this snowberry poultice for them. It's the only thing that helps. Snowberries? I thought that was just from fairy tales, like cloudberries, I say. As though I know anything about fairy tales. I think the only thing my old man ever read to me was the racing form. I don't know what a poultice is either, but I don't bother with that one. She laughs, and there's that bell again.
No, snowberries are real. They're the white, waxy ones. My grandma used to take me out to pick them back home.
She leans closer to me on the bar. And that warm feeling between us is coming back. It's pretty much charging back.
Those eyes, silver. And that second beer. And everything.
I don't even ask her where back home is, even though she said not 10 minutes ago she grew up right here.
The berries, she says, just inches from me now, are so white. And they have a wee little nipple at the tip.
I want to say something very badly, but wisely take another drink instead.
When you break them open, she says, almost a whisper now, a whisper I can feel humming through me. They look like sparkling snow inside.
And when you taste them, I ask,
you would too. You don't want to taste them, she says, shaking her head and leaning back. The Indians call them corpse berries. They won't kill you, but they're dangerous.
I'll bet, I say. Then, after a beat, but it might be worth it.
It might, she says.
And we look closely at each other.
Something has happened.
I feel like we both just put our hands onto the poker felt and spread them. She puts her glasses back on.
If this were a murder mystery, she says, you'd be accusing me of poisoning someone.
But we're not talking about poison, are we? I say. We're talking about a gun. No flinch this time.
resting back against the bar. She picks up one of her swizzle sticks again.
"How did you know?"
she asks. "It was a lucky shot," I say. "Luckier than yours, you missed him."
"You mean he's not?"
"No," I say. "He's left town. He's far from you, believe me." But there's a very angry pair of bullet holes studding his oak bookcases. She turns and looks out the front window again, as if she could see the bullet holes from here. I see her chin shaking just slightly. But that's the closest sign I see to anything resembling a reaction. I find myself wanting to tell her about Death Watch beetles. How they are like bullets in their own ways. That funny ticking you hear in old buildings on quiet summer nights. The loneliest sound. But I don't. You came within inches of 30 years to life at Taconic Correctional Facility, I say. What was your idea, anyway? She pauses a second, her face clouding over.
You know the thing about herring?
She finally says, looking me straight in the eyes.
It's a bait fish.
I don't say anything.
But, she says, you're actually wearing pinstripes.
Turns out, her aim is true. I always heard it was a forager fish, I say quietly.
And yet you're not police,
she says, resuming her majorette routine.
Or are you?
No, I say. He wanted to keep this quiet. He thought it might be you. He wanted to be sure. I see the silver of her eyes glistening faintly.
Well, there's that, she says. But I guess now is when the law comes in.
I catch my reflection in the rusted mirror behind her and quickly look away. That's not up to me, I say. We both sit for a minute.
What was your idea, miss?
I say again, my voice a little ragged now. I shouldn't have had the beers. I shouldn't have thought this would be easy green right before the holidays. Somehow everything's turned and I can't turn it back.
You wouldn't understand, she says. It was a very long time ago. Long ago to him, not to me.
When he told me about her, about the two of them, he'd said as much. He'd said it sadly, like it was his great regret. Not that he'd ended it, but that he hadn't seen how she'd never be able to let it go.
You didn't have to stay, I say. There's plenty of places to go. No, there's not, she says. But can you imagine what it's been like? Seeing him go about his life, be so happy?
Sure I can, I think, but don't say. Isn't that what all of us do? People like us, the ones always on this side of the glass, looking in the frosted windows, glowing with all the things happy people glow with.
I can't explain myself, she says,
eyes finally lifting me.
It's a sick, blue life, and you can't know what you'll do, or why.
I think you can, I say.
You think that now, she says. Just you wait.
Give Till It Hurts by Donald E. Westlake.
It was hard to run, Dortmunder was discovering, with your pockets full of bronze Roman coins.
The long skirt flapping around his ankles didn't help either. This hotel is either too damn big, he told himself, huffing and puffing and trying to keep his pants up under this bulky white dress, or it's too small. Okay, the dress isn't really a dress, it's an abba. But it gets in the way of running legs just as much as any dress in the world. How did Lawrence of Arabia do it in that movie that time? Probably trick photography. Also, the sheet on his head, called a keffiyeh, held on by this outsized cigar band circlet called an akal, is fine and dandy if you're just walking around looking at things. But when you run, it keeps sliding over your eyes, particularly when you have to go around a corner and not run straight into the wall, like now. Dortmunder turned the corner, and here came a half dozen of his fellow conventioners,
Arabian numismatists jabbering away at each other and kicking their skirts out ahead of them as they walked. How did they do that? Dortmunder braked hard to a walk, to a stroll, and fixed a brotherly smile on his face as he approached the approaching sheiks, or whatever they were.
"Swami,"
he said, using the one word he'd found that seemed to work.
"Swami, Swami."
They all smiled back and nodded and said some stuff and proceeded on around the corner. With any luck, the cops would arrest one of them. Here's the thing. If you happen to hear that in a big hotel in midtown Manhattan, there's going to be a sale of ancient coins, where most of the dealers and most of the customers are going to be rich Arabs, what can you possibly do but dress yourself up like a rich Arab, go to the hotel, mingle a little, and see what falls into your pockets? If the dealer with the heavy beard and the loud voice hadn't also happened to see what was falling into Dortmunder's pocket, everything would have been okay. As it was, he'd eluded pursuit so far. But if he were to try to leave the hotel by any of its known exits, he was pretty sure he'd suddenly feel a lot of unfriendly hands clutching at his elbows. What to do? What to do? Getting out of this OPEC drag wouldn't help much, since his pursuers had no doubt already figured out he was a goof in Sheik's clothing. In fact, wearing it helped him blend in with the hotel's regular guests, so long as he didn't have to engage in conversation more complicated than, "Swami, Swami,
Swami, ho, ho, Swami."
And at least he wasn't got up in Santa Claus rig. Every year around this time, with shiny toys in the store windows and wet snow inside your shoes, wherever there might happen to be any kind of a robbery in a public setting, the cops immediately would nick the nearest Saint Nick. Because it was well known that Santa Claus is every second-rate, second-story guy's idea of a really terrific disguise. Not Dortmunder. Better a sheet among sheiks than a red suit, a white pillow and handcuffs. Leave your camel at home. No admission. That was what the door said. And that was perfect. That was exactly what you would look for when you're on the run, a door that says no admission or authorized personnel only or keep out. Any of those synonyms for quick exit. This particular door was at a turn in the corridor, tucked away mostly out of sight in the corner of an L. Dortmunder looked down both lengths of empty hallways, tried the knob, found it locked, and stepped back to consider just what kind of lock he was expected to go through here. Oh, that kind. No problem. Hiking up his skirt, reaching into a coin-laden pants pocket, he brought out the little leather bag of narrow metal implements he'd once told an arresting officer was his manicure set. That cop had looked at Dortmunder's fingernails and laughed. Dortmunder manicured no admission, pushed the door open, listened, heard no alarm, saw only darkness within, and stepped through, shutting the door behind him. Feeling around for a light switch, his fingers bumped into some sort of shelf, then found the switch, flipped it up, and a linen closet sprang into existence. Sheets, towels, tissue boxes, soap, quart-sized plastic coffee pitchers, tiny vials of shampoo. Well, hell, this was no way out. Dortmunder turned and reached for the doorknob and felt a breeze. Yes? He turned back, inspecting the small but deeply crowded room with all his eyes. And there at the rear was a window, an ordinary double-hung window, and its bottom half was just slightly open. What floor am I on? Dortmunder had gone out windows before in his career that had turned out to be maybe a little too high up in the air for comfort, and he'd lived to regret it, but at least he lived. But where was he now? The window was behind shelves piled with towels. Dortmunder moved towels out of the way, leaned his head in between two shelves, pushed the window farther open, and looked out into December darkness. A kind of jumbled darkness lay in an indefinite number of stories below. Maybe three, maybe five. To the right were the backs of tall buildings facing 57th Street, and to the left were the backs of shorter buildings facing 56th Street. Didn't people make rope ladders out of sheets? They did. Dortmunder followed their example, first tying the end of a sheet around the handle of a coffee pitcher,
and lowering that out the window, then tying sheets together and playing them out until he heard the faraway clunk of the pitcher against something hard. Far away. Don't look down, Dortmunder reminded himself, as he tied the top sheet to a shelf bracket and stripped at last out of his Middle East finery and switched off the linen closet light. But then he had to figure out how to get this body from this position, standing in the dark linen closet, to hanging on sheets outside the window. How do you get from here to there? To slide between the shelves and out the window head first seemed utter folly. You'd wind up pointing the wrong way, and you wouldn't last long. But to get up on the shelf and through that narrow opening feet first was obviously impossible. Well, the impossible takes a little longer, particularly in the dark. Many parts of himself he hit against the wooden edges of the shelves. Many times he seemed certain to fall backward off a shelf and beat his head against the floor. Many times he had all of himself in position except one arm on the wrong shelf or maybe one knee that had found a way to get into the small of his back. Then there came a moment when all of him was outside the window except his left leg, which wanted to stay. Ultimately, he was reduced to holding onto the sheet with his teeth and right knee while pulling that extra leg out with both hands, then in a panic grabbing the sheet with every molecule in his body just as he started to fall. The sheets held. His hands, elbows, knees, thighs, feet, teeth, nostrils, and ears held. Down he went, the cold city breeze fanning his brow, his descent accompanied by the music of ancient coins clinking in his pocket and tiny threads ripping in the sheets. The jumbled darkness down below was full of stuff, some of it to be climbed over, some to be avoided, none of it friendly. Dortmunder blundered around down there for a while, aware of that white arrow on the side of the hotel in the evening dark, pointing its long finger directly at him. And then he saw, up a metal flight of stairs, a metal grillwork door, closed over an open doorway, with warm light from within. Maybe? Maybe. Dortmunder tiptoed up the stairs, peered through the grill, and saw a long, high room completely encased by books. A library of some kind. Well lit and totally empty, with a tall Christmas tree halfway along the left side. Dortmunder manicured the metal door, stepped through and paused again. At this end of the room was a large desk and chair. At the far end, a long marble-topped table, and in between various furniture, sofa, chairs, and a round table. The Christmas tree gave off much bright light and a faint aroma of the North Woods. But mostly the room was books, floor to ceiling, glowing amber in the warmth of large, faceted overhead light globes. At the far end was a dark wooden door, ajar. Dortmunder made for this, and was halfway there when a short, gray-haired guy came in, carrying two decks of cards and a bottle of beer.
"Oh, hi," the guy said. "I didn't see you come in. You're early."
"I am?"
"Not very early," the guy conceded.
Putting the cards on the round table and the beer on a side table, he said,
"I have this right, don't I? You're the fella Don sent to take his place because he's stuck at some Christmas party?"
"Right," Dortmunder said.
"Pity he couldn't make it," the guy said. "He always leaves us a few bucks."
He stuck his hand out.
"I'm Otto." "I didn't quite get your..."
"John," Dortmunder said, fulfilling his truth quota for the day. Diddums.
"Diddums?"
"It's Welsh."
"Oh."
Two more guys came into the room, shucking out of top coats, and Otto said,
"Here's Larry and Justin."
He told them, "This is John Diddums. He's the guy Don sent."
"Diddums?"
Justin said.
"It's Welsh,"
Otto explained.
"Oh."
Larry grinned at Dortmunder and said, "I hope you're as bad a player as Don."
"Ha ha,"
Dortmunder said. "Okay, it looks like there's nothing to do but play poker with these people and hope the real substitute for Don doesn't show up. Anyway, it's probably safer in here for the moment." So Dortmunder stood around, being friendly, accepting Otto's offer of a beer. And pretty soon Laurel and Hardy came in, Laurel being a skinny guy called Al, and Hardy being a non-skinny guy called Henry. And then they sat down to play. They used chips, $1 per, and each of them bought $20 worth to begin. Dortmunder, reaching in his heavy pockets, pulled out with some wadded greenbacks and a couple of bronze coins, which bounced off the floor and were picked up by Henry before Dortmunder could get to them. Henry glanced at the coins and said, as he put them on the table and pushed them toward Dortmunder,
"We don't take those."
Everybody had a quick look at the coins before Dortmunder could scoop them up and slip them back into his pocket. "I've been traveling," he explained.
"I guess you have,"
Henry said, and the game began. Dealer's choice, stud or draw, no high-low, no wild cards. As Dortmunder well knew, the way to handle a game of chance is to remove the element of chance. A card palmed here, a little dealing of seconds there, an ace crimped for future reference. And pretty soon Dortmunder was doing very well indeed. He wasn't winning every hand, nothing that blatant. But by the time the first hour was done and the cops began to yell at the metal grillwork door, Dortmunder was about $240 ahead. This was Otto's place.
"Now what?"
he said when all the shouting started out back, and got to his feet and walked back there to discuss the situation through the locked grill, looking as though he didn't believe it, or at least didn't want to believe it. Al said,
"They're raiding our poker game?"
"I don't think so," said Henry.
Otto unlocked the door, damn his eyes, and the room filled up with a bunch of overheated uniformed cops. Several of them with new scars and scrapes from running around in that jumbled darkness out there.
"They say," Otto told the table generally, "there was a burglary at the hotel and they think the guy came this way.
He scored some rare coins,"
one cop, a big guy with sergeant stripes and Perry on his nameplate, said.
"Anybody come through here tonight?"
"Just us," Larry said.
Nobody looked at Dortmunder.
"Maybe,"
one of the cops said. "You should all show ID. Everybody but Dortmunder reached for their wallets. As Otto said,
"Officer, we've known each other for years. I own this building and the bookshop out front, and these are writers and an editor and an agent, and this is our regular poker game."
"You all know each other, huh?"
"For years,"
Otto said, and grabbed a handy book and showed the cop the picture on the back.
"See, that's Larry," he said,
and pointed at the guy himself, who sat up straight and beamed a big smile as though his picture was being taken.
"Oh, yeah?"
The cop looked from the book to Larry and back to the book.
"I read some of your stuff," he said. "I'm Officer Nicola."
Larry beamed even more broadly.
"Is that right? You ever read William J. Connett?"
the cop asked. Larry's smile wilted slightly.
"He's a friend of mine," he said.
"Of ours," Justin said.
"Now there's a real writer," Nicola said. "He used to be a cop himself, you know."
"We know," Larry said. While the literary discussion went on, Dortmunder naturally found himself wondering,
"Why are they covering for me here? I came in the back way, I showed those coins. They don't know me for years, so why don't they all point fingers and shout, 'Here's your man, take him away.' What's up? Isn't this carrying the Christmas spirit a little too far?"
The symposium had finished. One of the cops had gotten Justin to autograph a paperback book. The cops were all leaving, some through the front toward the bookstore, the rest returning to the jumbled darkness out back. Otto called out after them,
"In case anything comes up, how do we get in touch with you people?"
"Don't worry," Sergeant Perry said. "We'll be around for hours yet." And then Dortmunder got it. If these people were to blow the whistle, the cops would immediately take him away, meaning he would no longer be in the game. And he had their money. You don't do that.
You don't let a new guy leave a poker game after one measly hour, not if he has your money, not for any excuse.
And particularly under these current circumstances. Knowing what they now knew about Dortmunder,
His new friends here would be replaying certain recent hands in their minds and seeing them in a rather different light, which meant he knew, unfortunately, what was expected of him now. If this is the quid, that must be the quo. Otto resumed his seat, looking a bit grim, and said, "Whose deal?" "Mine," Justin said. "Draw, guts to open." Dortmunder picked up his cards, and they were the 3, 5, and 7 of spades, the queen of hearts, and the ace of clubs. He opened for the $2 limit, was raised, and raised back. Everybody was in the hand. Since it didn't matter what he did, Dortmunder threw away the queen and the ace. Justin dealt him 2 replacements, and he looked at them, and they were the 4 and 6 of spades. Has anybody ever done that before? Dortmunder had just drawn twice to an inside straight in the same hand and made it, and made a straight flush as well. Lucky, huh? If only he could tell somebody about it. "Your bet, John," Justin said. "I busted," Dortmunder said. "Merry Christmas." He tossed in the hand. It was going to be a long night. $240 long. Schemes and Variations by George Baxt. Christmas in New York. No longer the kind that once inspired Yuletide songs destined for a prominent place on the hit parade. Yet after 62 years, the Rockefeller Center Christmas tree was still a big attraction. It towered over the ice skating rink, facing Fifth Avenue as proud as an aged whore who could still score tricks. A bunch of vendors catered to the holiday tourists, mostly women from all points of the country wearing stretch pants that emphasized their watermelon-sized buttocks. Two-fisted women with a nosh in each hand, clutching a knish, a hot dog, an oversized pretzel, a soft drink, wearing backpacks or sporting oversized handbags stuffed with boxes of cookies, candies, and sandwiches wrapped in tinfoil, prepared for the famine they thought might overrun the city. They were unaware that a murderer was threading his way among them, hurrying to a destination 6 streets further uptown, and dreading to let his employer know the mission was unaccomplished. His victim didn't have the manuscript, just as 2 earlier victims didn't have the manuscript. Damn these victims, did they have to be such disappointments? 2 hours earlier, at Kennedy Airport, a young man in an ill-fitting chauffeur's uniform stood at an arrival gate. The jet from San Francisco was on time, a rarity for this particular airline, noted for its poor service but pretty stewardesses. The chauffeur held high a cardboard on which was crudely penciled, "Jonathan Lake." He had seen a snapshot of the man standing in front of the Fifth Avenue library with a woman who seemed to look impatient. Lake, in his 60s, looked like a diplomat and carried an attaché case that added to the impression. Now the chauffeur studied the faces of the men disembarking. They were mostly young or middle-aged, carrying suit bags, briefcases, or department store shopping bags stuffed with gifts. Most of them looked as though the parade had passed them by, if there had ever been a parade. There were squeals of delight as some of the passengers were greeted by friends and relatives and business associates. The chauffeur heard a strong voice telling him, "Young man, I am Jonathan Lake." He could have been announcing the second coming of Christ. "Oh, good," said the chauffeur. "I was beginning to think I might have missed you."
"I am rarely missed," said Lake with authority. "I was making a date with a stewardess. Pretty thing, redhead. I'm partial to redheads. Especially when they whisper in my ear, 'What are you doing later, dear?' Terribly brazen, don't you think?"
His eyes twinkled, and the chauffeur wasn't sure he believed him.
"She must think I'm disgustingly rich."
"You are disgustingly rich," thought the chauffeur, who knew him to be one of the world's most respected dealers in rare books and manuscripts. Lake was questioning him.
"Who sent you? I didn't order a limousine."
"I'm from Otto Penzler, the mysterious bookshop."
"And on the 7th day, he rested. How nice of Otto to be so considerate. I had no idea he knew I was arriving. Thank God you're not from that deadly Dora Lester woman. The chauffeur picked up Lake's overnight bag, then reached for his attaché case. Lake pulled back. I'll carry this myself. Yes, sir, said the chauffeur. Traffic into New York was worse than usual, almost bumper to bumper. The chauffeur was a careful driver. He had no choice. Although Lake felt as though they were advancing towards the city by inches, they actually were doing about 20 miles an hour. I loathe Christmas, said Lake. The chauffeur said nothing. It's a conspiracy between Macy's and Kmart. The only worthwhile thing the communists ever accomplished was the abolishment of Christmas. He paused and said, I hate Yom Kippur worse. Christmas time, you at least can feast. On Yom Kippur, you aren't allowed to eat, which is why Chinese restaurants are always jammed then. Don't tell me we're on the Triborough Bridge. We are, sir. Well, you certainly snuck that one up on me. He paused. Why didn't you take the 59th Street Bridge? Jammed. Bumper to bumper. I used it coming to the airport. I was afraid I'd be late. Did I tell you where I'm staying? No, sir. I was about to ask. The Plaza. I always stay at the Plaza. If you have to stay someplace in New York that isn't a friend's apartment, stay at the Plaza. Despite Donald Trump, the Oliver North of real estate. The limousine was leaving the bridge. Jonathan Lake peered out the window. This is Harlem. What are we doing in Harlem?
I'm taking a shortcut, sir. This will take us to 2nd Avenue. At 72nd Street, I'll cut over to 5th Avenue and then down 5th to the hotel.
Lake was still staring out the window.
Where are we? Why are we on this street? There's nothing here but derelict buildings. There's not a soul in sight, not even a mugger. Young man, this is dangerous. What the hell are you doing?
The chauffeur had parked outside a ruined brownstone. He got into the back seat with Lake, pointing a handgun at Lake's head.
This is crazy, Lake sputtered. This can't be happening to me.
It's happening to you. Open your bag in the attaché case.
Take my money. Go ahead. I've got lots of money.
He was reaching into his jacket for his wallet.
Don't! And make believe you did.
Lake was perspiring despite the freezing temperature outside.
I was only reaching for my wallet.
Open the bag in the attaché case.
Lake said,
The keys are in my coat pocket.
Which one?
This one, the left.
The chauffeur patted the pocket. He felt the keys. There was no weapon.
Okay, said the chauffeur. Now, use the keys and be quick about it.
When the bag and the attaché case were open, the chauffeur rummaged about in them.
I can't imagine what you're looking for.
The manuscript, damn you, exploded the chauffeur. The goddamned manuscript.
I have no manuscript. I have contracts and agreements, that's all I have. I'm only here for a couple of days to close two deals. That's the truth. I'm telling you the truth. I have no manuscript with me. What is this manuscript I'm supposed to be carrying?
The Dashiell Hammett, you idiot. The Dashiell Hammett.
The bullet smashed into Lake's head, between his eyes, just above the bridge of his nose. No improvement on the cosmetic surgery Lake had endured 40 years earlier, thereby miraculously turning a Levitsky into a lake.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.